the birth anniversary of the Prophet. It is also the month of Hijrah. And for us, Hijrah is a very important phenomenon in our faith and history. If you look at the Islamic calendar, it's important to see that it doesn't start with the day when the revelation of the Quran started, the day of Ba'asat. Doesn't even start with the birth of the year, the birth of the Prophet. Doesn't start with the day, the year of the wafat of the Prophet. Many other incidents took place in Islamic history in the days of the Prophet. Rather, the choice went for Hijrat. Even in Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this concept where he has put the words Iman, Jihad, and Hijrat all together in many, many places. And so Hijrat plays an important role in Muslim history. It also is very instrumental as far as the spread of Islam around the world is concerned. You know, especially although we hear this propaganda against Muslims, that Islam was spread by them by the sword. But if you look at the example of, for example, the largest country as far as the population is concerned in the Muslim world, it is not in the Middle East. It is in Far East, Indonesia. And no Muslim army ever, you know, stepped in that area. This was an area which came into the fold of Islam, not by military might or conquest. It was actually because of the missionaries, especially the Sufi missionaries who had gone there earlier, and the behavior of the Muslims, especially in their dealings with others. That is the lesson that we have to learn here. When we talk about the migration to the West, it was the akhlaq, the honesty, integrity of the Muslim merchants which influenced the non-Muslims of that area, you know, to look at this faith. And this is a very important phenomenon when we talk about, you know, how we deal with non-Muslims in the process of migration. Even the Prophet, when he came into Medina, already the two major tribes, the inhabitants of Medina, Aus and Khazraj, had already become Muslims. This was because of the hard work of a young muballigh, or a missionary, that, or a teacher of Quran, that the Prophet had sent at their request earlier. And so when the Prophet came in Medina, already it was a majority Muslim city. But then immediately the Prophet realized that there was a minority Jewish community there. So what does he do? He doesn't say, all of you get out. He called them in a very peaceful, cordial manner, sat down and said, since we are both communities are sharing the same city, the same resources, you know, our dynasty, our destiny, and as well as our security is all common, so why don't we sign a pact and an agreement? This was the first, you know, the agreement that the Prophet on behalf of the Muslims is concluding with the Jewish minority in Medina. And if you look at the terms, it shows that, you know, Islam is not a religion which is going, you know, after other people, to eliminate them, to kill them, to push them out of their land. This is not Islam. Yes, we know that the Muslim rulers later on went into what is known as futuhat, you know, the campaign for conquest. But that was not necessarily to convert the people. It was more to conquer those lands. And any serious historian of Islam knows the distinction between the one and the other. Salawat. Looking at this agreement that the Prophet signed with the Jewish minority in Medina, you know, this brings me to this whole trip of our prime minister to the Middle East. You know, if you look at that agreement, that was the basis of how the Muslims conducted themselves. you know, through the centuries, we might not agree with many, many or majority of the rulers who came into power after Rasulullah, but on the whole, in spite of all this propaganda that we see against Muslims, if you compare centuries of history of how the Christian rulers treated the Jewish minorities in Middle East as well as in Europe, and how the Muslim rulers treated the Jewish minority under their rule, you will see there is a big difference. Unfortunately, those, you know, centuries are now being just, you know, blanked out from the minds of the people, especially in the West. You will see that the treatment given by Muslims to Jewish minorities under their rule actually brought about the survival of the Jewish community. You know, their safety, their security was there. And one indication of that is the golden age of Jewish philosophy, which flourished not under Christian rule, rather under Muslim rule in Muslim Spain and in North Africa. One of the most famous Jewish philosophers by the name of Moses Maimonides, he actually lived at that time. He was born in Spain under the Muslim rule. And that whole tradition of Jewish philosophy flourished under Muslim rule. And then he died in Egypt under the Muslim ruler over that place. And this is where we come to realize that when it comes to the Muslim-Jewish relationship in history, you know, we are being portrayed as those who do not like the minorities, which is not a true portrayal at all. According to the Jewish history, the biggest event is the Holocaust. Who did that? Was it, you know, Muslims, Arabs, or Palestinians? No. It was done by Germans, white, Caucasians, Christians. Remember after 9/11, you know, one of the reporters met Muhammad Ali, the boxer. And he said, how do you feel that people of your religion did this? And he says, how do you feel that people of your religion did Holocaust? And the reporter didn't have anything, no follow-up questions. You know, you just think about history and then you come to realize that we don't have to be ashamed of ourselves or of our history. And this is where when we talk about what is happening in the Middle East, you know, we are basically talking about what is just. What had the Palestinians done? What had the Arabs done? What had the Muslims done against the Jewish community? Nothing. You know, it was the Germans who did it. If you have to really take a revenge, do it with them. And this is where we see that, you know, it is in this background that the Canadian Muslims are disappointed with the one-sided tilt in the Harper's government towards the state of Israel. You know, in his speech there, he makes a comment where he says this idea of anti-Semitism is taking a new face. Even this idea and the concept of anti-Semitism is a European Christian concept. Didn't exist in Arabic language, didn't exist in the Arab culture, didn't exist in Muslim culture at all. Because when you say Semite, Bani Israel and Bani Ismail are all Semite. So you couldn't even have conceptually this concept of anti-Semite in the Arab literature or in their terminology. And this is where, you know, we see that even criticizing the unjust policies of the state of Israel is termed by Mr. Harper. He says this is new face of anti-Semitism. I think, you know, the remark made by one of the columnists of the Toronto Star, Heather Mallick, she writes very well. It says, what an insult to the many Canadians, including some Jews, who strongly disagree with Israeli policy. Implying they are anti-Semite is extraordinary. Who is Harper to demonize any Canadians exercising the right to speak openly, even harshly, as long as they do it within reason? And this is what we have to think about, you know, living in this part of the world. We have to live according to our principles. Yes, sometimes it becomes very difficult when you see the zulm done against fellow Muslims in other parts of the world. We have to talk about it. We have to side the mazlum. We have to oppose the zalim. But within, you know, reasonable limits and according to the legal limits of the country. And that is Islamic and civic duty of the Muslims in Canada. Let me, you know, end with a very beautiful description here by Rick Salatin, who is a common, you know, regular columnist in Toronto Star. He's a writer in his own right and a critic in literature. He has even got awards for his books. While describing Harper's visit to Israel, he begins by a thought. I'm sure many Muslims share that. He says, "At first I thought the trip was simply about making it official. Canada now is a province of Israel, at least when it comes to foreign policy." End of quotation. Salawat alaykum wa rahmatullah. And so, you know, we are not the people who go around and hate others. It's a matter of justice. You know, look at history and then look at going back all the way to the accord signed by the Prophet of Islam in Medina between the Muslims and the Jewish minority of that city. In Ahsan al-Hadith, Kitab Allah al-Aziz, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wal-Asr, inna al-insana lafi khusr. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العطوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين والشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين الى سبيل الله بالحكمه والموعظه الحسنه قاده الامم واولياء النعمه ومعدن الرحمه اوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبه عما سلف من ذنوبكم. It's also a week where we saw, you know, on one hand we had Muslims at Milad al-Nabi. Unfortunately, there are others. In the name of Allah and Rasul, do things which are totally against the values of Islam. You know, this whole issue of Syria is coming up again and again. And there also you see the same takfiri, Wahhabi, extremist elements coming forward. And the question becomes, many people ask this question, what would be the religious perspective about Syria? The question would be, what is the choice? On one hand, you have an undemocratic government. But then on the other hand, you have the takfiri Wahhabi elements supported by groups like Al-Qaeda. So what is the choice? Of course, the choice will be lesser of the two evils. Nobody is saying, you know, one is good and one is bad. It is a matter of what is the lesser of the two evils here. When you look at the takfiri element, you know, whenever they get involved in anything, their language, their philosophy, their ideology is violence and nothing else. They don't want to sit down with books. They don't want to have debate and discussions with others. The only language they speak is the language of violence and weapons. You know, suicide bombing is becoming a very common thing that they use, targeting civilians. In marketplace, in churches and mosques, you know, wherever they find innocent people, even the religious caravans, you see the situation in Pakistan at the moment. And now this is not, it's not only confined to Syria, Lebanon, Iraq and Afghanistan and Pakistan. Now it's even reached this week Egypt. And so this is basically a cancer, which, you know, unfortunately people are not looking at this issue. Even the Western powers, as I said, they still just open one eye. They still have to open the other to look at the true picture there. You know, look at the situation in Quetta, these groups of, you know, Zawar coming from Iraq and Iran by road, enter into Balochistan area, somewhere near Quetta, and that's where the suicide bombers attack them. About 20 of these Shias, and their sin is that, what? Nothing but that they went for the ziyarat of the a'imma of Ahlul Bayt. 30 of them were killed. Many, many have been injured. And this is where, you know, while we condemn this and pray for safety of the Muslimin, and especially for those who have been injured, that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them full and complete recovery. Let me repeat what I said a few weeks ago, that we have yet to hear any statement from the Canadian government about the attacks on the Shia minority in Pakistan. And the reason I'm bringing this issue again and again is because Harper government has established what is known as the Office of Religious Freedom, specially to support religious minorities around the world. But as I said before, it seems that only when the minority happens to be a Christian minority, they condemn violence against them. But when it is a Shia or someone else, they really don't care about it at all. And this is where we talk about, you know, justice and fairness, and really to bring Canada to a level where it was universally respected by the world. And that will only happen when there is true understanding of the events around the world. Allahumma salli ala sayyid al-mursaleen wa shafi al-mudhunabin nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. Wa ala imam al-muttaqeen wa amir al-mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام وعلى أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام.